So welcome everyone, and welcome very much also on behalf of the team at Delta Metropole, Anna-Krita and Malvika Vera, who have prepared this session together with me. Welcome to this special session on day two of the pre-congress of ISOCARP. We're in Doha, well, not really actually, but as it seems, floating above Doha. The Congress, the real Congress, will happen on site between 8th and 11th of November. But we are part of a program that is still online, and that is also a convenience, particularly in international conferences I have come to experience. So I'm looking forward to a great interactive meeting today. So I hope you will be able to join in the conversation. We are continuing a conversation, of course, when we look at energy transition and climate planning. This will be a continuing conversation for a number of years. But for us, it started more or less in 2016. With first preliminary study into the spatial consequences of the energy transition. And most recently, during the Rotterdam Architecture Month, we held a 3-hour working session trying to bridge the different skills, hence the title, the Matryoshka Effect. How can you connect the different skills from the front door to Paris and look at all of the dilemmas, look at all of the different perspectives, and also focus on how to come from strategies and ideas into action. And of course, particularly in the interdependencies between different skill levels, between your neighborhood, your city, your region, the country, between different ways of looking at the energy transition, quite a lot of action is lost, maybe lost in translation, and I think it's therefore important to try to bridge these gaps. So also today, from two very different perspectives, we want to continue this conversation in this special session, and we would like to focus our discussion a little bit on the scale of the mega region of the Euro Delta, to be more precise, in which the association Delta Metropolis is located in Rotterdam, but we are looking at the larger urbanized region of about 40, 50 million inhabitants, and how they can not only share a common history and culture and identity, but also how they can build on a common future. And of course, there we need climate planning and we need energy transition. I'm also very happy to say that we are doing this not only ourselves, but in a great consortium. We've partnered up with Matrix and ISOCARP in focusing on this Euro Delta, and thus also supporting the coordination of cooperating municipalities in the SURE Euro Delta cooperation that's now coming to it's growing, you could say, and it's growing both in network but also in content, and we are very happy and proud that together with Matrix and ISOCARP we're there to support that growth. ISOCARP will also launch the community of practice focusing on this region, and I'm also looking very much forward to what happens there. We've done at the beginning of the year a very nice interactive session, the Next Generation Podium, with help of all kinds of students looking at the Euro Delta, and we will take that further also in establishing a scientific board to get into the science on board of this skill level. So I think it's exciting to be working on that, and I think very useful to focus on. Today, we will focus on the energy transition, as I said before, with two introductions from two very different perspectives. So I'm really curious how that could lead to an interesting conversation. We will have the two introductions with, of course, some space for asking questions. If you have one, please use the chat also for that. And then we will have a second part in which we will have a more open debate. And I really hope you will also participate in that debate as an audience. We will try to facilitate this also by spotlighting you if you want to be included in this conversation. Be aware you are recorded, as you saw probably already with a notification on your screen already. The recording is going on. It will be also available. So if you don't want to be visible, you need to turn off your camera yourself. That is your own responsibility. So we will have two perspectives. One looking at the, basically the bottom upwards, you could say, how energy communities work, how they can scale up, how they can work together. And of course, in this line also how different initiatives can learn from each other. Sylvia Assalini from ICLE Europe will introduce two researchers she's been involved in, and will highlight some outcomes in that, and I'm really looking forward to that. And we have another perspective really from the other side of the spectrum, you could say, of the energy infrastructure system, the network. Alan Kroes will start with a recent perspective. The network organization, network companies of the Netherlands have created a perspective on the future of the network in the Netherlands based on analyzing different scenarios. I think it's really interesting and also super timely that this scenario study has been undertaken. We've already been in conversation that the interaction between the network and the space is very important in a densely urbanized country as the Netherlands, which also is true, of course, for the whole mega region of the Eurodelta. And of course, there's transborder questions that then arise, like where does the system really end and how should we cooperate? On what skill level should we cooperate? Of course, we have already quite a lot of interaction already between the networks in Europe. So how does that perspective change our view on the Eurodelta and what can we learn from that? So without further ado, I would like to introduce the first speaker. I already mentioned her, Sylvia Assalini. She is a climate and policy and energy governance expert at ICLE Europe in Brussels based at the moment. So great that you can join. And she will be introducing two recent researchers, looking at energy communities and how also this transition can be a just transition. So I'm looking forward to your presentation. Sylvia, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. And actually connecting from Doha. thank you again for inviting me and inviting us to participate in this very interesting event that I'm part of the Sustainable Resources Climate and Resilience team at ICLE Europe. I would just give a quick run through our organization, as I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with that. And I think it gives you the framework to understand better what we do. So ICLE is an international organization. As you can see, we are worldwide present with 22 offices, and we have this subtitle that is quite eloquent. So we local government for sustainability. In a nutshell, what we do is to represent local government's interest in policy development, policy making at the European level, but also at the worldwide level. And for what regard climate and environment in general. At the same time, we do support our member to develop low emission, nature-based, equitable, resilient, inclusive and circular strategies for their own areas. So I think that what you mentioned about connecting scale, it's really fitting to our work as well. Just two traits, there are characteristics from our organization, I'd say. We are membership based and we do not have any threshold. So we do welcome all local governments, and by local governments, we intend any level of governance that is below the national one, so cities and regions. The other very important element is the holistic approach that we do have towards sustainability. So what you see on the screen are the different divisions within our organizations. We hope to cover sustainability in a very broad sense. And what we try to do in our daily work is to really connect those elements and to see sustainability, not just from the environmental perspective, but also the economic and the social ones. But you might wonder, why do we focus on local governments? Well, this is because local governments are responsible for the implementation of most of the national and EU level regulations. So they have to actually apply what is decided on the above level. And they do have also some room to adjust to the local context, which is very important. To do that, they have some budget allocated, often not enough, but still they have the possibility to address issues also from the financial point of view, and they are responsible towards citizens to provide services, and they are the first institution that citizens encounter, so they really allow to experience their democracy in a direct way. So what we have been observing in the last year is that also at the European level, so this is again very European centered, but I hope it reflects also other realities, but the European level, while the broad picture of EU policies is developing, at the same time we do see the recognition of the importance of the local level. So on side of the Green Deal, which is this wide package of revision of legislation that has to do with the energy, among the others, we do have the local Green Deals that address local governments, and we are working on that together with the Committee of the Region. At the same time, Vice President Timmermans have been launching the Climate Pact, that is this effort to really build a commitment between local government, citizens and businesses to really make the targets of climate neutrality by 2050 a possible one. Really connecting scale, but also going across different, let's say, area. Transdisciplinary is very important. And this is, again, at the EU level, something that we have been observing increasingly in the past few years. And this is definitely applicable to the energy sector. So what you see on the screen now are two European projects that we as ICLE are directly involving in, and those projects have been granted under similar calls that look at the social aspect of energy transition. So indeed, the infrastructure is important, technology is fundamental, but in the last decade, I'd say it's growing importance also how to get people on board, how to make sure that initiatives that are promoted and implemented are really have the backup also from the grassroots, let's say the citizens. So those two projects are Sonnet from one hand side, social innovation in energy transition, and Decide on the other side, which is developing energy community through informative and collective action. So those two projects, the interesting thing is they are looking at the same topic, so energy transition toward two different perspectives. So while Sonnet is having social innovation at its center and looks at how social innovation can be used, can be leveraged to really make energy transition possible. This side is looking at what is happening in the energy sphere and analyzing the social aspects in order, again, to make use of this knowledge and speed up this kind of initiative that I'm going to tell you a bit more later on. So just maybe one word on what is social innovation, as I'm not sure this is familiar to everyone. So it's about the change in the social relations, in the way that we do think and organize, new way of doing thinking and organizing energy in this case. On the right side of the screen, you see a different way of organizing those relations, whether an exchange, a cooperation, a conflict, or a challenge, or a competition. And by crossing those two axes, the colleagues at Sonnet have been developing and mapping out better a series of social innovations that are currently happening. And the one that you see in the first column on the cooperation with the little red star is the one that we within Sonnet have been implementing the most, which are city labs. And I'm going again to tell you a bit more in the examples, but in a nutshell, the possibility to create a space that is a space for exchange and connect citizens with municipalities, with all the other stakeholders, and develop together policies and a vision for the future development. On the other hand side, it said there is this other project, which is Decide. Decide is focusing on the concept of collective action. So I don't know whether you are familiar, but in the latest 2 years, the European Union has been approving two directives that introduce in the framework, in the legal framework, two identities that are the citizens' energy communities and the renewable energy communities. So what is important for me to stress in this content, the context of this conversation, is that those communities there are seen as an active possibility to actively participate in the energy market for citizens, have the main purpose, must have, according to the law, the main purpose of providing environmental, economic, and social benefits to the member of the local area. So once again, we see the importance of locality, of engagement, and also of what we call co-benefits. So not just looking at issue as a technical one, but looking on how technical the energy can actually affect other spheres. What I want to share with you is the results of part of the results that we have been looking at in this Decide project. We have been investigating why people do join communities, energy communities of collective action. What is the driver? We might think that it's about environmental sensitiveness of the individuals or economic benefit they can gain, for example, by saving, installing PV panels on their roof. But actually, we found out that it's extremely important to have trust and to have trust in the organization and to have a common identity. So, of course, this is bringing to a completely different shift in how we do have to think and how we do have to act in order to make the transition possible. On the other hand side, the main barriers were administrative burdens, the low perceived any value of energy. So an accent here on the importance of knowledge sharing and of really having workshop and activities that can make people understand what is happening around them, this sphere. And then again, the lack of interest and involvement. And starting from this point, the colleagues have been and are still looking into how really make sure the people are involved in the policy and in design processes. And this is, of course, regarding us closely, because talking with local governments, many of them come to us saying, yes, of course, we have to include them, but we are not really sure how to. So here is where social innovation helps us a lot, from informing, so just make sure that they get the information and are aware of what's happening, up to have them participating in an active manner and co-creating policies. To give you, to close the presentation, just two concrete examples. One is in the city of Antwerp in Belgium, in the Flanders part. The city of Antwerp, interestingly, is participating to both projects. So they have been capturing the resources of Bonn exactly because they have a clear vision. And this vision is implemented and defined within the Start Lab 2050. So a space that the city have been creating to enable this dialogue and to really have all hands on deck in defining what are the action and how those should be implemented. And this is particularly important when we think about, for example, inclusion. As you can see in Antwerp, between 20 and 30% of households are experiencing energy poverty. And with the site in particular, one of the aspects that we are looking in is how those households can be involved in the energy community project so that they can have not only environmental benefit for the city, but also economic benefits from the share of the energy produced. And to briefly touch upon the cross-border cooperation, within the site, we do have a coffee shop that is a virtual space where we connect experiences that we in our experience, we saw that this is extremely important. And Antwerp in particular is exchanging with the city of Tartu in Lithuania and with Embro, which is a service provider here in Belgium. And they are facing somehow similar challenges. And therefore, for them, it's extremely helpful to see how others are tackling the same problem. The other examples that I want to bring to your attention are from a completely different perspective. Those are closer to the region that is on focus today, so you might know them better, actually. So happening in the Netherlands is the Buikstotterhang in Amsterdam and Adenhuizen in Oost, a neighborhood and an eco-village. And what is important here is that while in Antwerp was the city taking the initiative to build this cross-level dialogue, here are citizens going to the institution and asking to be recognized and to have this dialogue. And just last element, and to point out, again, to stress the importance of this, let's say, vertical integration, as well as the role the local governments can play in it, is that both initiatives have been possible because, of course, there have been this exchange. So the Amsterdam municipality allowed citizens to implement the first, let's say, settlement of the project, this neighborhood that decided to be energy efficient. On the other hand side, the Eco Village had the possibility to experiment, and this is extremely important to give space to experiment new things by being granted, being included in a regulatory sandbox agreement and being granted the experimental status that will allow to do things that otherwise will not be possible. So I hope I will not too much over time. I wanted just to give you a perspective of how local governments can really support and how important it is really to have a connection in between the different level and the different scales in order to make ideas that are like social, maybe theory, a real concrete actions in practice. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you very much, Sylvia, for your presentation, and it's interesting to hear of you this need of stimulating the communities working with energy transition, and that the role of the municipality is very important in that. And I know from a fact that in the Netherlands, municipalities are struggling with giving a place to the inhabitants and their initiatives. It's always very funny to see that the governments who are closest to the inhabitants, to the civilians, are also always struggling a little bit with giving them the space in order to allow certain initiatives to come to fulfillment. So it's very interesting that you emphasize this also and use your network to strengthen that it's actually not so strange to allow for some voice of neighborhoods in there. And of course, you also mentioned that the need for experimentation is very important. So I see that also from an interesting recent example in Rotterdam, where actually a very deprived neighborhood has shown that there is so much social capacity and social energy literally there that can really be built upon. So indeed, Mafika already asked in the chat if there's any direct question, we could take them now. Perhaps there is some, I saw some people from municipalities attending in the group. So perhaps there are some questions or experience to be shared at this moment. If not, I don't think so. Then let's continue, and then we do the talk afterwards. But we continue with a poll question, since we would like to have this as an interactive session, even if you don't want to ask direct questions at this moment. We will ask you to vote for a poll. And the poll question is quite straightforward, actually, of course. So perhaps, Mario, we can get that on the screen.
Sure.
So the poll question is, are you undertaking actions to help achieve the climate ambition outlined in the European Green Deal? Of course, I expect a yes, but you can specify whether it's professionally or through civic participation or both. Not mentioned, but perhaps it can be part of this. Is that you do it yourself for your own household will be interesting also to see. So is the poll already there?
Yes, I just need a few seconds.
The question is straightforward, but poll taking, not always. Yes, there it is, right. So please vote. See how active our group is in terms of participating in helping achieve the ambitions. Well, we still would like to get a little bit more answers, if that's possible. At least half would be nice. So if maybe someone can still vote. Some of you didn't vote yet. Yes, well, I think we should do it with this. Mario, perhaps you can share the results.
Sure.
So we have quite even field, I would say. And a little bit disturbing is the fact that there are people still not participating in helping to achieve the climate ambitions outlined in the European Green Deal. So this is literally a call to action. I think maybe those people can start by participating in civic action, outlined by Sylvia. I think it's a great way to achieve something in your own neighborhood and own living environment, particularly if you manage to also include, Sylvia said, the co-benefits of the changes that need to take place. Sylvia, how do you look at this poll?
Yeah, well, surprising that there is some no, unfortunately. But yeah, as you were saying, that is it's not an easy task indeed. From our experience, local governments are really trying to understand how this can be and can be done. And as you were saying, it's not easy from them all to really translating concrete steps. For example, I had an experience of an event. We were discussing about youth engagement in that case on climate action. And there was a municipality from Finland saying, look, we have to redo the climate plan. We do want to have citizens involved and youth involved. We just have no idea on how to do that. And that is where exchange is really important.
Yeah. And how about this civic participation? Do you have some own experience with that as well? Like, would you be in the last category? Are you involved in some own community projects in your living environment?
Yeah, in a sense, not as much as I would, but we did have here in Brussels a community participatory budgeting process, so everyone could actually submit project, vote project, and participate in plenary meetings to discuss what have been being the priorities. And I think it was very interesting and a very good way to have people on board. Then the second step, of course, would be how to get to reach who is outside of the bubble. Because, of course, the ones that are already engaging in any climate and environmental aspects, they are more keen to join. They might even be active in looking for it. But then there is a big part of the civil society that is just not aware or not that let's say committing, and that is our next level, let's say.
Yeah, well, I recognize this very much. Yeah, so I'm also maybe a little bit more in the second category, professionally working on trying to achieve goals, but in my own neighborhood it's quite a challenge. And I noticed that I talk about the subject a lot with neighbors, and no real action has come forward still. So So there's room for improvement in my case, and I guess in quite a lot of our cases as well. So thank you for now, Sylvia. You will be joining later on in the discussion. But I would like to continue now with, like I introduced, the complete other side of the perspective. You could perhaps say the technical perspective, the perspective of the energy infrastructure, the network. How should it prepare for this change? How is it already, of course, changing? I'm very happy to introduce Alan Kroes, who is working for TenneT in the Netherlands, the network operating a company who is also, I think, has some responsibilities in Germany as well, if I'm correct. So in that sense, already knows a little bit about what's going on cross-border. And he will introduce, like I said, the recent report, which was very interesting, since it is really something that the network companies, I would say, I was waiting for this report to happen, a perspective on the future of the network. We all know how important the network is in this transition. We already in the Netherlands see it in practice, how crucial the network is in the energy transition, in the sense that not everywhere all new initiatives can be connected to that network at the moment, simply because there's not enough capacity. So it's very important to look forward, and it's also very important to look forward with an eye to the energy mix that is perhaps possible in the future. So I'm really very happy that you can introduce the different perspectives and the different scenarios that were put forward in this report. So I would like to give you the floor, Alan, and please go ahead.
Thank you very much, Paul, and happy to be here and give you a perspective. Like you mentioned, let me first introduce myself, Alan Kroes, responsible with Intenet, which is an electricity transmission system operator. So responsible for our high voltage and extra high voltage grids. So if you see some lattice towers in the Netherlands and indeed part of Germany, probably we're, let's say, involved in those infrastructure. But also from my role, quite active in the European Association of ENTSO-E, which is an association dealing with the interest of the TSOs for all Europe, meaning 42 of those associations. Looking at what has just been presented, I think I have an easy job because I only look at the energy and not all the different aspects as such, but we still try to recognize and take into account all the other interests. So with this, I would like to bring you indeed, let's say, some perspective of the study that we've done and how we're using it. So looking at the energy system of the future, what we aim to do is to look not in the first 10 years, because there every company already has an investment plan procedure and is working on it. But we recognize with the energy transition, it's not the first steps that are, let's say, the most uncertain, but it's really when you go to a decarbonized system where you really have to turn over and rebuild your whole energy system as such. It will work differently. It will react differently. So we went to 2050 to try to figure out what can we expect, what can we look at. And what we also recognized is it's not only an electricity part, it's also not a gas part, but it's trying to look at it from an integrated perspective of all energy carriers, all energy sources, looking also at heat, how will, let's say, the fuels translate into a decarbonized system, and what kind of impact would it have? This study also tried not to only give a perspective in 2050, but also try to look at, okay, how will you develop it from 2030 onwards? So let's say building upon the already investment plans of the grid operators and go further to 2050. And in this perspective, the aim was to indeed give an outlook. What are we facing? What we need to pick up and address so we can prepare ourselves for a decarbonized system in line with the climate agreement goals as such. Below you see the different companies that have contributed here, being Gasunie from gas, TenneT, high voltage, but also all the distribution operators going into the cities, which you are aware of. Been published this spring. Now, this study has not been done in total isolation, and we have been working in this study trying to take different things into account. We started with, let's say, first creating a scenario report and really involving the stakeholders from different perspectives, different items, and trying to create a common view of which kind of future scenarios should we pick up. Next to that, the Ministry of Economic Affairs also added a nuclear energy perspective, given that this was also a part to look at, so that has been added. But what is also important, it has been recognized from the beginning, we can draw a lot on the paper, but in the end, it needs, let's say, space to build the infrastructure. So the spatial impact has been picked up in parallel and looking at what does it mean if we would, let's say, build upon this energy transition. What kind of spatial results would that need? And that means that all has been taken into account in the final report. The scenarios that we've used, we've tried to look at from different perspectives, one being a very regional one. So that there is a lot of regional development, self-sufficiency as low as possible, but at least on national level. Local project, so a lot of solar, district heating, and the energy intensive industry would go down. national development already enhances the system and looks more from a national perspective, where you see more or less a move to much more offshore wind, stable industry. If we go to Europe, we see we came up with a scenario where you try to organize Europe as a self-sufficient part, which is not completely possible for Europe as a whole. So Europe still needs imports, given there is not enough space to generate all the renewable energy within the space available for Europe. So adding the CO2 tax or the border compensation part, where one of the for 55 proposals is this CBAM. And then a more international part where we say, okay, it's not about policy driving to look at your own area, but there is a global market and this market will be CO2 free, but a lot of imported possibilities because there is free trade and the industry will grow. So different perspective that we've used, trying to look what does this mean, what kind of impact does this have for our infrastructure, and what do we need to prepare for? Three main observations. Even looking at, let's say, massive use of flexibility, being most optimal in where to site all the parts, especially for the electricity grid, we still see that the decarbonization will ask a lot through electrification. So that means that our current electric grids, whether it's on a national level or let's say local level or European level, needs quite a lot of expansion and we need to modify quite a lot. This is really, let's say, kind of a no regret. We've also seen that given that we're going to rely a lot on solar and wind, the volatility of this will demand a big need for flexibility and storage, because otherwise we're not going to be able to secure the security of supply like we're used to and like we need to keep the society running. Each day, each second of the year, throughout the season, and also in years where there is less wind and less solar going forward. And that also gave us the realization that if you look at the space and the cost of the energy system, it will increase. We didn't have, let's say, all the costs from the oil part in such a way, but we do see that if we want to organize it like this, there is a cost increase that we need to take into account and pick up. And the other thing is the challenge is quite big. So feasibility is an urgent issue, looking also at technical personnel and the current lead times for expansion, where permitting, of course, is a big part of it. So these were, let's say, three main observations. Going with you a bit more in detail, we have seen that if we want to make the system work, there will be a need to have a kind of an integrated system between electricity from solar and wind with hydrogen to make sure that the hard-to-abate sectors can also keep running on CO2-free, but also that the electricity system is able to be secure, because seasonal storage currently, there is no other option available within the current technology sphere. So looking at how to develop the hydrogen grid is one of the crucial items. And I think this also has been picked up in the Dutch environment, where the government has stated that they are willing to support the build out of a hydrogen backbone to start this hydrogen chain, value chain, because currently as a backbone, it's non-existing. There is hydrogen, but those are business-to-business specific infrastructures. And as you can see, it's needed in all the four scenarios. So that's also why, let's say, it's considered as a no-regret development. The other part, like I mentioned, electricity. Here I've just taken a picture looking at if we want to deal with the wind, offshore wind mainly, the 380 kV of the Netherlands will also be needed to distributed to Germany and Belgium, because the North Sea of the Netherlands is, let's say, quite a big asset, but it definitely has a surplus compared to our own needs. So how to share that within Europe, how to make sure that the interconnections to the countries and our internal lines to transport it are feasible and realized to make it happen. But we shouldn't forget what needs to be done also on local level, on regional level. And local distribution companies have also tried to identify what does it mean. And that means that they came up with, in the Netherlands, 60 to 80,000 kilometers of trenches has to be digged up for new cables going to 2050 to facilitate this whole electrification going forward. And these graphs show that if you look at where we are today with the climate accord, the climate agreement, the first bar in the graph is already, let's say, a step forward to what we are used to today. But if we look at the scenarios going to 2050, you can see the huge increase of additional infrastructure needed compared to, let's say, the current one. So the challenge also in cities and in the metropoles are quite big. Flexibility. As mentioned, we see that large capacities are needed. So we need to think about how to redesign the system to make it work. One of the items is also we should accept and understand that sometimes curtailment, so cutting down the wind or the solar, is maybe the cheapest solution. So let's not try to capture all energy, because in the end, for social, let's say for society, that's the most expensive part. Where exactly the balance is, of course, needs to be looked at. But still, we see quite a lot of peak not being facilitated by the infrastructure as the most cheapest solution. We also see battery storages. Batteries, we've recognized that probably you can only take care of a 24-hour cycle, solar day-night rhythm, not for longer timeframes. Power to gas definitely is part of it. So seasonal storage, picking that up. But then you also need the power plants for security supply, because when there's no sun and solar, you need some electricity. Of course, heat is also a part where it should be considered in the whole flexibility part. How to take this now into account going towards, let's say, space is a second step that has been taken. So these are all results from our study that we've done in the Netherlands, looking at four different future views. But this study has also been integrated in current developments within the Dutch government in trying to figure out how to create the space available. So here we can see that with this study, trying to facilitate also the high-level spatial decision, what has been done, how has been picked up. And there, the government has also taken into account, okay, let's try to figure out what it means that if we use the scenarios regional, national, European, and international, and use it in the way that we as grid operators have, let's say, taken the best location for all the equipment, what kind of space requirements are needed, but also trying to look at a different angle and to say, what if we would concentrate certain functionalities much more in areas and what the government mentioned, the strong nodes. So we're not going to disperse solar all over, but we're going to concentrate it in a few areas that we're going to kind of designate for solar or onshore wind. Also again, on the numbers from our system in the regional, national, European, and international scenario. And as mentioned, the government also looked at the nuclear. Also here, these are kind of a strong nuts. Where do we pick that up? The other part that is also looked at is how do we look at interconnection? So you see the arrows mainly in European and international, and because those are the ones where we really are looking into looking at from a more a broader geographic area and trying to figure out what does this mean, how does this pick up. So this program has been called Programma Energie Hoofdstructuur, so the program for energy main infrastructure. And this approach, this PHA, has looked at how to create different alternatives, so to support decision making, assess the impact, and provide going forward to decisions. And the next step would be to also start creating the spatial reservations and to for the development areas, for the infrastructure, and take policy statements going forward to make things happen. The other thing that also the study showed and all this discussion is, while infrastructure footprint is smaller compared to solar and wind farm, it's critical to address, but definitely, let's say solar and wind farms will take a lot of more space, how to pick that up. But our line infrastructure is critical and should not be forgotten if we want to make the transition feasible going forward. So, Paul, I hope this helps you to give, let's say, a kind of view, inside view of what has been ongoing in the Netherlands, trying to derive, let's say, future scenarios and what kind of impact it has on energy in the Netherlands going forward.
Yes, great. Well, thank you very much, Anand. It's indeed, like I already said, I think it's it was a step I was looking forward to, and particularly the interaction with the spatial development. I think it's interesting to see that that is also taking shape further now in terms of not only looking at the space that is needed for the network, but also thinking of the development of other uses and how the interaction with the network maybe leads to different choices in terms of where you would concentrate certain ground uses, perhaps even thinking differently about where to place new housing extensions, etc., etc. So I think it's a very interesting take on things. Just out of curiosity, Alan, are you involved in a very local own initiatives in terms of this challenge of the energy transition yourself?
If I look, let's say, in a community sense, not as such, but locally on my own roof, there are solar panels. So let's say, take some steps, but in a local energy community, not.
Well, at least I would expect that from you to have the energy panels on the PV panels on the roof, of course. So there is a question from Frank de Hond, Secretary General from ISOCARP. Frank, would you like to rephrase the question yourself since you're here?
Yes, thank you, Paul. Thank you, Alan. Well, I mean, as an association of urban and regional planners, we're of course always concerned about the spatial impact of sectoral policies. So energy is one of them. And of course, the sectoral policy has its own aims, reducing carbon emission, but we as planners, we have to have a more holistic view on how it interacts with other needs of society. And one of them is, of course, the need for space for all functions of life. Let's call it that way. And you know, we planners, the planning community, is a bit anxious, I would say, about the enormous spatial claim that the so-called renewable energy could have on green fields. You know, if it only to replace brownfields with new energy, that would not be a bad idea, but probably that's not the case. So is there any estimation in your studies or in related studies from the Ministry of Environment or Spatial Planning, if there is still one in the Netherlands, how much space is needed for this energy? And then I'm really referring to green space, green fields.
If you look at the study, we try to identify with very rough estimates what kind of space requirements we're looking at. And there we indeed, let's say, also recognize that the space from infrastructure itself is marginal. If you look at, let's say, the total, let's say, area. And the biggest part is indeed solar and wind. They need the space. Wind, of course, has, let's say, it depends a bit how you look at it, because you can still have between the windmills another usage, but not everybody wants to live just in between the windmills. So it depends on what kind of other usage. And solar at this moment, indeed, is a bit a question whether you're going to put it on existing buildings or you're going to use green fields. We have more or less identified what is the area that you need. We're not a policy instrument, so we didn't put it either in green or on buildings. There are some discussions now in the Netherlands where indeed the subsidies and the, let's say, for the projects, it's cheaper to build big solar parks on greenfields. And this is currently being indeed quite discussed, whether we should facilitate that and in what way should we facilitate it, or should we push it a bit more back to, let's say, not the cheapest solution, but go indeed for buildings and existing rooftops. But this is more, let's say, a Dutch discussion at this moment, which I assume also is happening all over the world. But
can I just maybe follow up? A follow-up question is, how much do you collaborate with the Ministry of Spatial Planning, if it still exists? So is that a collaboration? Do they do their own studies? How does it work?
My last slide, what I mentioned, the program for, let's say, the main energy infrastructure is done together, or is more or less guided by the Ministry of Economic, of, let's say, for spatial planning. And what we collaborate with is indeed to explain and to make visible what our study from infrastructure perspective means. So trying to come with the alternatives, trying to assist in how to look at the impact assessment and how to prepare the decision-making. So let's say our, and that's, let's say, something that I kind of find quite progressive in the Netherlands. We have found a way currently to really cooperate together with the ministries, trying to tackle this problem going forward. And it's at least not a fight. We don't always agree, but we're trying to make it work together.
Yeah, great. And indeed, I think there's definitely a long way to go to continue on that line. As Frank hinted, the holistic view that the Netherlands used to be so famous for on the national level in terms of planning. Well, we lost that a little bit, and it's coming back in a grand way. I expect it also needs to be. We all realize that there's so much demand for the same square kilometer everywhere, and this part of the energy transition is one extra. It's on top of all the other elements. We, as an association, also work together with a lot of, well, you cannot see it in this way, with a lot of spatial designers in order to come up with this plan 5 years ago. So I think it's also still very useful to see how the network and the space can be more precisely studied.
Paul, might I add one comment, because I think Frank mentioned something important indeed. The choices that we made currently, or that we're making as policymakers for going to a decarbonized system through solar and wind, implies more space. I mean, the energy density of solar and wind is much less than the current, let's say, conventional units. And that's, let's say, maybe has been an implicit decision, but it's something that, let's say, from infrastructure, it's kind of a given for us, given the policies they're pushing for. And that's indeed something to really realize, that the energy density, for example, with the nuclear, what I mentioned, compared to solar, has massive difference.
Yeah, Yeah, that is incomparable indeed. So it's interesting to continue on that line research. There's a question from Alan Krita, also reflecting to your role in the European cooperation. Do these scenarios, or perhaps other scenarios, also play a role in this discussion in Europe? And how does that lead to changes in collaboration between countries?
Yeah, I think if you look at Europe has been organized from the energy system quite well, because we are a kind of regulated entity and the easiest to steer, so to say. And that has also delivered quite a lot of directives from the European Union, where ENTSO-E, as the European Association, also has a responsibility to deliver a 10-year network development plan. And that 10-year network development plan is also looking at scenarios where we jointly with the gas sector create a common scenario with twice quite a huge consultation phase to get all the interaction with different parties, including NGOs, etc. And there you see that, let's say, the local national scenarios are also being used to create these European scenarios, and vice versa. So the European scenarios we've been creating are also being used in the national scenarios, because what I've shown you is the Dutch view, but it could only work if I also take the European perspective to look at what kind of cross-border interfaces there are. So there is quite a big exchange going there. And if I read, let's say, also the question as such, there are also now collaborations ongoing on member state level, trying to figure out, can we do things together? For example, offshore wind currently is something that the Netherlands is looking, together with Germany and Denmark, how can we make this happen in a way that it's a European perspective? Because only connecting it radially to the Netherlands without looking what kind of impact it has on Germany and Denmark doesn't make sense. So also on that level, there are letter of intents, studies and collaborations trying to bring things together.
Yes, well, that's an interesting answer. And maybe it's a good moment to get Sylvia in the conversation as well. Since Alan Krita also posed a question to you, but perhaps it's also interesting to hear the reflection from Alan afterwards, like how can we include, does it make sense, maybe is more of the question, to include the societal views and contributions in this kind of scenario thinking. But maybe Sylvia first, would you like to react to the question of Anna?
Yes, with pleasure. So, well, thank you for the question, of course, and thank you, Alan, for the very interesting presentation of taking the same issue from a completely different perspective. It was extremely interesting and always very enriching, especially because we do realize how much we do have to talk in order to find a solution. And it's great, I think, to hear that you are actually in close cooperation with the national level. Because of course this is making all your work at least something that can be really lead to some concrete results, let's say. And well, from the societal perspective, let's say, as Alan Krita called it, I do tend to, yeah, let's say the scales do apply as well, of course. And from our experience, it's way easier to cooperate between people than between governments, of course. So we have been observing like experiences of peer-to-peer market where according to, let's say, users and people, this is absolutely something that there will be fun of and support. But then when it gets to let's say, enable these options, here is where we find problems. Also, when we discuss about energy community, for example, there is a lot of discussion on how those energy communities can go across borders. Of course, municipalities sometimes are really just a few kilometers one from the other. And this is indeed an open discussion. Member states are at this very moment called to transpose the directive into the national law, and we see great difference in how member states are interpreting the directive. So that's why actually we are working together with our like-minded organizations, just to mention one is the Community Power Coalition, to really make sure and advocate towards the European Commission that member states do their homework and do transpose the directive, sorry, in the way that is consistent, so that there is the physical possibility to do cross-border exchange when it comes to energy communities. But unfortunately, yeah, nowadays this is not possible. And yeah, if I may add something on the discussion that it was just before, I think that here is where the societal perspective really makes the difference. So the question from Frank was whether the estimates were considering greenfield or brownfield. And Alan rightly mentioned that there is cost in difference in between these two options, but I guess that if we will include the societal perspective, this the final results of this analysis would point toward probably a different result. This is also a moment that is extremely interesting from the policy perspective and from the social sciences perspective, because we are seeing more and more the demand and the need to set a clear set of KPI indicators that could measure and make accountable the societal benefits in order to include those in the overall, let's say, analysis. This is not just for taking decision at the policy level, but for example also to getting grants in order to fund projects. Most of the time the economical aspect is the only one that has been considered, and it makes a lot of sense, but at the same time there are a lot of other benefits that it's difficult to be to translate in monetary value, and therefore are left out of the picture, but indeed should be included as they exist.
So thank you very much for that reflection. Just before we will introduce Malvika actually will introduce a tool that we have, the mural board, to allow all of you to hand in some ideas and projects that you know of. But just before that, I would like Alain to reflect on what was just said, and it's also something that that Chuck Doornenkamp mentioned in the chat, that basically, of course, you can make the system stable by introducing technology and making sure there's more storage available, your network can cope with it, but likewise you could do it by changing behavior of people and including that perspective in the equation. You did not really look at that part of society yet, right? Or did you?
Good question. Looking at first, indeed, the social aspect. What we have kind of realized, we were in past years not visible enough what we were doing and why we were doing things. Mm-hmm. So the low awareness of, let's say, what the energy infrastructure entails, what you need, is, let's say, still something that let's say doesn't help us. I even had some discussions that let's say people are discussing the high voltage grid, the necessity for that, because on their household they are only using low voltage. So the fact that it's coupled is not, let's say, realized or looked at. And a bit like maybe what was mentioned by if we would be able to better balance our own household, the less would be needed from the grid. Yes, we need a kind of change also in behavior, and the more it changes, the less I have to do as a grid operator. And given all the challenge that we have, I'm definitely pushing for as much as possible that everybody pitch in and helps, because the challenge shouldn't be only our problem, but it should be from all partners together, industry being one of them, but also households indeed. But on the other hand, we should also recognize the kind of behavior, because if you look indeed at solar, and given that I have now the solar panels on my rooftop, I also sometimes look at, okay, how much does it produce? But as soon as there is a kind of clouds passing, it drops dramatically. And if I just started my washing machine or whatever, I should stop it and then restart again. And all these kind of things should also be held, because you're not going to sit continuously as a consumer behind your dashboard. Okay, now a bit more, now a bit less. So we also need to facilitate those kind of elements. And I think there is going to be a kind of trade-off between some sort of flexibility and some sort of behavior which works out and which picks up. But definitely our intention is also, and especially with, for example, electric cars, we have now engaged into pilots that we're steering from centrally, from a national perspective, if we reduce the loading capacity from all electric cars that are connected to this pilot. And trying at that perspective to also create a kind of behavior within the limits that people allow us to. So from that perspective, behavior is something, but it's not a full, a complete solution. And one of the things that are the most strict for us as, let's say, energy community is the seasonal storage. How to make sure that during a winter, when there is a long period of cold, where there is low wind, solar is, let's say, going down, how can we still supply all the energy that's needed? Because in the end, we should think about the fact that the energy that we're consuming, not only at household, but also in our industry, is massive. It's definitely quite big. So it's not small infrastructure that you need to make that happen.
Clear. Yes, so thank you very much already for that answer. I would like to give Mafika the floor just shortly to introduce the mural board that probably the link you will be able to find later on in the chat, so that you can add your ideas. Also, when we have already closed the session. So Mafika, can you introduce the board?
Yes. Yes, we have really good discussions going on from the two different perspectives, from Alan and Sylvia, but we also want to open it up to the audience. So I'm just sharing my screen here. I hope you all can see. So we want you to provide examples of projects that are in line with the discussions happening. So connecting different scales of climate action, be it local, regional, national, cross-border and across different aspects, so societal, spatial, infrastructure and economic. So please take a sticky note from here and place your different projects that you have, different examples that you have, onto the board. I think you can find the link in the chat.
Yes, well, great. Thank you so much. I hope we get some input from all of you. Perhaps you already know the mural board from other sessions. It is always a great help, and I think it's also nice to have input from all of you. So please use that facility. I would like to have Alain and Sylvia on the screen, both of you, to go to the last part of our conversation, basically. And I think one element which was mentioned in the chat, which is really quite important at the moment, I think, that Marie de Ketelaere, she mentioned. So I don't know, Marie, do you want to want to come to the screen and make your point, because I think it's very important to have your perspective. And I'm really happy that you're here to join. So perhaps you can join.
Yes, thank you,
great.
Paul.
Great to have
thank
you.
Thank you, everybody, and a warm bonjour to our colleagues from around the globe. Yes, I was just mentioning it. I guess it's the case in many countries, European countries at least, but certainly in different ways all around the world, that the current increase in energy, especially gas price, is putting many people in a very difficult situation, added to the COVID crisis. And in our country, we observe that more and more people can't pay the energy bill. And I would say even people, for instance, who I've got a friend, she lives in social housing. I take this example. So it's okay, she can pay the rent. But now the situation is that the bill of energy is as high as the rent. So she has just the very minimum. And that's the case of the millions of people, I think. So this is a very important issue, which has to be seen both on the energy economy and social aspect. And you remember maybe that the Yellow Jackets movement in France started from the idea of a carbon tax on diesel, and those citizens, many people had been encouraged to buy two cars because they live in remote places, and to buy diesel cars. And after that, they are said for good ecological reason, but that now it's over and they will have to pay more. So if the people in our society who are in the most difficult position, if this situation is not taken into account and by society as a whole, if you only ask people in difficult situation to make the effort, I think it's raising much anger and political difficulties and all that. And those people say, okay, but I that's the opposition in French. We call this entre la fin du monde et la fin du mois, between the end of the world and the end of the month. And this is a very important issue, because if we don't address this, we can't make our way. Maybe what I say is a little bit confused, but again, I think that the links are to be made strongly, because if not, many people won't embark on ecological challenges because they even don't know how to pay the bill. That's what I want to say. Thank you.
Yeah, well, thank you very much, Marie. So it's very nice that you can join. As Patrice Generale from the council, who looks into these kind of elements in France. And I would also, I think Alain already said that it's very important that it becomes more visible, the role that the networks play in terms of having a place in this discussion. So I think that's very interesting. But what you also point to is the connection between the long-term, large-scale, and the short-term, the end of the month, and your own household, and it becomes very quickly, very acute, important to be able to come up with answers in this. How do you, Marie, from your perspective in France, how do you cope with that? Because indeed you address the difficulties in getting people on board, particularly now in this situation, which is so necessary in order to make the jump to, let's say, the next generation and the larger scale. So do you see any possibilities there?
In fact, for instance, and I guess it's the case in some other countries, the government decided that there is going to be an energy subsidy or check given 100 euros to help pay the bill, but it's very short term and it's not enough because now people are indebted for more money than this. A short medium term issue on which we work a lot is the question of insulation of buildings, because there is the energy, the best energy is the one you don't have to waste. And in fact, many buildings are poorly insulated. So part of the bill comes from that. So there is a very large program managed by the Ministry for Ecology Transition I belong to, a wide program to insulate and to renovate buildings. I think this is a very important issue, and local authorities, especially regions, are very much involved, because the idea is to offer a service to people. For instance, people can pay ahead for the cost, so the local authority pays the businesses, the companies, who the workers who make the insulation or the works of the renovation of the building, and then after on the bills, these savings with these people pay back the local authority. Yeah. And there is also kind of engineering, because you know it's difficult between the regulations, the budget, the timing. Many people can't manage that. So yeah. There is national and local engineering, and I think this is a good example, because the renewing of buildings is a huge issue.
Yeah. So thank you very much for that perspective, and indeed also pointing towards one of the things that Alan said. Is the need for technically skilled people in order to make this change going. I think we're all looking for the same people as for the building of the network and for changing our homes. Sylvia, you want to reflect on that? You agreed very much with Marie.
Yeah, it's the comments with Marie resonate very much. And thank you also for sharing this nice a sentence. I mean, not nice in the meaning, but nice in the message between the end of the year, end of the month. I would use it if you allow me, because
it's,
I think,
not
it
mine,
captured,
but
it captured very, very well. Yeah. We also saw, I posted in the chat earlier a link to a workshop that we had just last week, and we were addressing municipalities exactly on this issue of energy poverty. So there are member states that don't even have a definition on energy poverty. So this hints to how much this issue has to be investigated more. The energy poverty is basically people not having the possibility to heat or cool their house in the appropriate manner as one of the main indicators. And we did also have during the workshop the experience of municipalities in Macedonia, I guess it was, that were basically doing social housing, giving lodgements for free to people that would not be able to pay the rent. But then the material of construction was of course the cheapest one, the efficiency of the apartments was so low that basically the amount that they have to pay to heat it up was like higher than they would have been in a normal rented flat. So I do also see this is a growing issue. I've been under discussion for several years now, especially in the eastern part of Europe, where we have those massive building blocks that have been built during the Soviet era. And during the 70s, they are also having issues, of course, in terms of insulations. And one example that I've been shared during the workshop, and I really invite you to go and have a look at it, because it was extremely inspiring, is from the Tartu Regional Energy Agency, that is part of the site project. And the Regional Energy Agency is supporting the city to really have the people, the inhabitants association involved and to start off with the refurbishment project combined with the solar energy. And as Maria was saying, a similar process where the energy would allow produce and the saving in the bills will allow to kind of compensate with the payback that they will have to advance, the money that they have to advance to proceed with the works. So something very similar. And I think here again, and I'm glad to hear that also Maria is working toward it, municipality can play and should play a great role.
Yeah, good. Well, we're running up to the end of the session already, actually. So there's, again, like always, too little time for discussion. The mural is getting forward quite nicely, actually. A couple of projects being mentioned there. Be Sustainable from Brussels, a couple of other things I know of. So it would be nice if you can join further with that. Look, there's things happening there. But I would like to end with a concluding question to both Alan and Sylvia. Really going back to the Euro Delta scale level, so the direct cross-border collaboration question that we would like to address, and maybe also a little bit with an eye to the next step. So I would like to ask you to reflect on the question: what would be a necessary next step in terms of working together in the Euro Delta when it comes to the energy transition? What is the thoughts on that? What is necessary? I can imagine very much like what happens already also in the spatial circumstances, that people on both sides of the border make use of elements on the other side of the border, and how to make use of that. So I'm curious what you think. Alan, would you like to start off? We cannot hear you. You're muted.
Yeah. No, that's fine. Looking at what can we do? What I also let's say hope to exchange with you is the fact that we are rebuilding the system from an energy perspective. That means new value chains are being set up. And one of the things that I think is not, let's say, done properly yet enough is, let's say, alignment on planning of those, setting up those new value chains. And what I definitely know that if we don't do it as harmonized as possible, the cost will increase even more. Because if we build, let's say, offshore wind, which is not used, we have to curtail it, throw it away. If we have users that are changing to electrification and there is not enough renewable available, we'll only increase the CO2 emission. And it's these kind of elements where also getting permits to realize things, getting space, getting the possibility. Sylvia showed also that there are some sandbox ideas picking up. The sandbox idea is great, but I think we are at the moment that we shouldn't try out with two small things anymore. The problem is too big. So we should start trying and also accept the fact that we are innovating on a larger scale. So our pilots should become bigger, not, let's say, the house that you mentioned, it should become bigger. The impact is getting bigger. And I think that's where, let's say, collaboration is needed, because nobody is able at this moment to really, let's say, take on the risk for this adventure alone. And that's where I see that if you look at, okay, where can we pick up? The metropole is big enough to really have an impactful development of those value chains beyond what you can do in an area, let's say, where you can bear the risk.
Yeah. So thank you very much, because that is indeed a call for scaling up, but also making projects on a scale level that is really relevant in terms of really providing this change and the importance of then aligning the choices in the value chain that you want to make. And of course, we know that this also involves experimentation and trial and error. I mean, there will be no other way than to make these steps. Sylvia, would you like to also reflect on the same question?
Yeah, well, I think I also fully support what Alan just said in terms of scaling up. We are now experimenting, and those little pilots that we are looking at, I hope they will become more and more in terms of not only quantity, but also numbers of members that they get in board. Of course, we are taking it from two different perspectives. So maybe my scale up is not exactly the scale up that Alan was looking at. But I think that it's clear that connecting scales is the point. So as Alan was saying, it's not only happening on the high level. There is a contribution that individuals can bring to this, and they should definitely have the space to do that. And one thing that I think is also essential that Alan also, I was happy that to hear that he mentioned, is the need of capacity building. So people must be aware of what is possible. They have to have the tool to take action. And this is starting from the inhabitants of the neighborhoods, knowing what is going on in their neighborhood, but also, as Alan was saying, at the local government level and national level, make them aware of those possibilities that are out there. And this is influencing last point that you was mentioning about cross-border cooperation. Of course, this is only possible if policies at the high level are do aligned. And I think that with this double effort, we can kind of push towards the good directions.
Yeah, well, great. Thank you very much for these insights. Also, I mean, I feel very much with you. There's no time to waste. So it makes sense to build this capacity and to have more people thinking with us and understanding the basics of what we're aiming for and what we're up against. So very often you sense that there's actually so much lack of understanding of what it is actually that we're talking about. This kind of massive movement that we will have to make on all different skill levels. So I hope we have contributed a little bit, at least within this session, in this setting of the ISOCARP pre-Congress. So I'm very happy to that we had this opportunity, and I would like to thank Sylvia and Alan very much for their contribution and everybody attending as well. As said, the mural will stay open so you can contribute a little bit more, and I wish you all the best in the rest of the Congress if you're joining other sessions as well. And I hope we can continue this conversation in another setting, in another project, in another idea later on as well. So thank you all very much, and once again to Sylvia and Alan for their contributions as well. Thank you very much.
It was a pleasure.
Thank you to you.